distribution ki, Shishi Kartik Mas Damodar ki, Kai Gaut Premanandi. All glories to assemble devotees, all glories to assemble devotees, all glories to assemble devotees, all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Ajnanat Mirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamin Iti Namine. Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharane Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschat Deshatarane. Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 14, Chapter entitled Lord Krishna Explains the Yoga System. Text 20. Na sadhayati mam yogo na sankhyam dharma udhava na svadhyayas tapas tyago yatha bhaktir mamorjita. Na sadhayati mam yogo na sankhyam dharma udhava na svadhyayas tapastyago yatha bhaktir mamorjita. Na sadhayati mam yogo na sankhyam dharma udhava na svadhyayas tapastyago yatha bhaktir mamorjita. Na sadhayati mam yogo na sankhyam dharma udhava na svadhyayas tapastyago yatha bhaktir mamorjita. Matajis. Na, not. Sadhayati, brings under control. Mam, me. Yogaha, the yoga system. Na, not. Sankhyam, the system of Sankhya philosophy. Dharmaha, pious activities within the Varnashrama system. Uddhava, my dear Uddhava. Na, not. Swadhyaya, Vedic study. Tapaha, austerity. Tyagaha, renunciation. Yatha, as. Bhaktihi, devotional service. Mama, unto me. Urjita, strongly developed. Translation and purport by disciples of His Divine Grace Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. My dear Uddhava, the unalloyed devotional service rendered to me by my devotees brings me under their control. I cannot be thus controlled by those engaged in mystic yoga, Sankhya philosophy, pious work, Vedic study, austerity, or renunciation. Purport. One may make Krishna the goal of mystic yoga, Sankhya philosophy, etc. Yet such activities do not please the Lord as much as direct loving service, which one practices by hearing and chanting about the Lord and executing His mission. Srila Rupa Goswami states, Jnana Karmadi Anavratam. A devotee should simply depend on Krishna and should not unnecessarily complicate his loving service with tendencies towards fruitive work or mental speculation. The residents of Vrindavan simply depend on Lord Krishna. When the great serpent Aghasur appeared in the precincts of Braja, the cowherd boys, completely confident in their friendship with Lord Krishna, fearlessly marched into the serpent's gigantic mouth. Such pure love for Krishna brings the Lord under the control of the devotee. So this particular verse is considered one of the classic verses in the Srimad Bhagavatam, very often quoted by the acharyas in various literatures, including the Sandarbhas by Srila Jiva Goswami, to establish bhakti as the one and only means of bringing Krishna under control. Not by jnana, not by yoga, not by karma, not by any other means, Krishna can be brought under His devotees' control. So, this section is a conversation between Uddhava and Krishna, and Uddhava is expressing his helplessness in front of the Lord, and he says, Tapatrena bhitasya ghore santapyamanasya bhavadvanisha pashyami na anyat sharanam tavangri dvandvat patrat amrita bhivarishad. The influence of the threefold miseries is causing me much pain. I do not see any other means of extricating myself apart from taking shelter of your lotus feet, which is like the divine umbrella which protects me from all kinds of rainfall of miseries from outside, and it also showers droplets of nectar from within. And then Krishna spoke the entire Uddhav Gita to Uddhava, and generally when a person speaks, the beginning and the conclusion is considered to be very important. Even for mortal human beings, the dying statement is taken very seriously. Similarly, when a person departs, he leaves behind a will. So Uddhav Gita is like the will of the Lord expressed to one of His most intimate associates, Uddhava, where the essential conclusions of his entirety of teachings have been distilled and spoken so that Uddhava can share this with the sages of Badrika Ashram. And therefore, here he is describing one of those essential verses which describes Na sadhayati mam yogo, that I cannot be obtained by yoga. It cannot be possible through yoga. Na sankhyam, not through sankhya, not through jnana process. The only way is Na swadhyaya tapastyago, not through swadhyaya, not through tapasya, yatha bhaktir mamorjita. Only through bhakti it is possible. And therefore, in this month of Damodar, Lord Krishna performs pastimes with Mother Yashoda. And so Kartik Mas is also called the Damodar month. And so in the 8th chapter of Srimad Bhagavatam, the background to this pastime begins. Krishna appears in Brajbhumi Vrindavan to demonstrate the power of pure love which is devoid of any conception of his majesty. Aishwarya heen madhurya yukta bhakti. And therefore, this is a very exalted experience which only the Brajavasis can have and they can share. And so the pastime in the 8th chapter, apart from the fact that Krishna has performed various intimate pastimes so far, in that particular chapter, Krishna begins eating dirt. And this is known as the famous Mrida Bhakshana Lila. And when Krishna eats dirt, the cowherd boys come and start complaining to Mother Yashoda that Krishna has eaten dirt. And then Mother Yashoda accosts Krishna and says that even Balram is complaining about you. Usually Balram is with you. And so at that point Krishna, he says that I have not eaten the dirt. All of these cowherd boys are speaking mithya. Sarve mithya bishamsanah. So the acharyas write that Krishna is telling that the cowherd boys are liars. That should not be taken literally by us. And we should not aspire to follow in the footsteps of them. But actually, they spoke the truth and Krishna is calling them liars. And Krishna says to Mother Yashoda that if you want, you can look inside my mouth. And at that point, Krishna opens his mouth and reveals the entirety of the universe. Brahmanda Darshan. So the acharyas give various reasons why Krishna ate that dirt. One of the reasons is Krishna has already declared paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam vikhana sartito vishwa guptaye sakha udeivan satvatam kule na khalu gopika nandano bhavan akhila dehinam antar atmadrik. So in the Gopi Geet, the gopis are glorifying Krishna as one who is all-pervading Paramatma within everyone's heart. And he appears in this world responding to the request of Lord Brahma. Vikhana, Vikhanas Arthito. Vikhanas is Brahmaji. When he prays, in response to his prayer, Krishna appears. And Brahmaji is praying for whom? Vishwa Guptaye. To protect Mother Earth, to deliver Mother Earth, to alleviate the sufferings of Mother Earth. So therefore, that is the purpose for which Krishna has appeared. And Krishna is thinking that so many years have passed, 4 or 5 years I have spent simply in playing, and I have not yet begun performing the main purpose why I came. Because the intoxication of the love of reciprocation with the Brajavasis has absorbed me so much that I have forgotten my seva. And so Krishna is feeling guilty. And sometimes we also go through like that. Some service is there, but we become absorbed in prasad. And then the conversation which surrounds a plate of prasad. So what should take 5 to 8 minutes, 10 minutes, takes sometimes half an hour, 1 hour. And then someone comes and says, hey, what about this? I said, oh, totally forgot. Why? Absorbed. So therefore, absorption is a function of taste. To the extent we have higher taste, to that extent we can become absorbed. And so Krishna was experiencing the higher taste of the love of reciprocation of the Brajavasis. And then Paritranaya Sadhunam was so enjoyable, he forgot Vinashaya Cha Dushkritam. Yes, a few demons which Kamsa had sent, Krishna had begun killing. But still, Krishna was thinking that I must make a statement to Mother Earth that I will somehow reciprocate with her. So therefore Krishna took a little bit of earth and ate, saying that project may be however huge, but it always begins with small steps. We should somehow make a small beginning. Otherwise, if you are thinking, I will begin one day, I will begin one day, one day, I will begin directly 16 round. When I feel inspired, I will begin. That day will never come. So you have to begin with one round, half a round, whatever you can. I will study Bhagavad Gita, complete 700 verses. When I get 8 hours a day. The day when I get 8 hours slot in my schedule, I will read. When that day will come, not in this lifetime. So therefore, even if you get 2 minutes, 5 minutes, one verse, you can always read. So Krishna is saying, okay, yes, the whole prospect of destroying millions of demons on the whole planet is very daunting. And Mother Earth needs to be relieved. But I can always begin small. And so Krishna also wants to show that he has spoken many lies, and in the Shastras it is said, if you speak lie, after speaking lie you must do achaman. Doesn't apply in Kali Yuga, we'll have to carry all the time. So the achaman is considered to be done with water or with mud also. So Krishna is trying to purify. Another reason the acharyas give is mud is also called vish. And so Krishna has just drunk the poison of putana. And so he has been infected by the vish. So he wants to counteract that vish, and vish counteracts vish. So therefore he is eating that mrida or mud. So Krishna, in these pastimes with Mother Yashoda, for the first time demonstrates his Aishwarya Bhav by showing the entirety of the universe within his mouth. So therefore Satyavrat Muni says, Namami Ishwaram Satchidananda Rupam Lasat Kundalam Gokule Brajamanam. So at the very outset, he is offering obeisances to a small boy who is not an ordinary boy. He is Ishwaram. He is a supreme controller. Because when we see Krishna in the form of a small boy, Mother Yashoda offering her love and affection to him, one may think, oh, this is happening in my house every day. So this is different from that. And so that personality is Ishwaram. And Mother Yashoda got a glimpse of the Ishwarata of Krishna through the Mrida Bhakshan Leela. And at this point, Mother Yashoda gets bewildered. And she sees these multiple universes, and she sees all of these things within the universe, and she starts getting bewildered. And when she sees the power and the Aishwarya, the real, raw, actual manifestation of the glory and the power and the influence of Krishna, she becomes humble. Many times devotees, they come and ask, how can I become humble? One devotee asked Radhanath Maharaj many years ago, Maharaj, please give me blessings to remain humble. Maharaj said, first become humble. Then you can remain humble. So how do you become humble? When we actually see the greatness and the power and the potency of Krishna, and that potency manifested through Krishna's devotees and through various manifestations in this world, yat yat vibhuti mat sattvam shrimat urjitam evava tat tat evava gacchatvam mama tejom shasambhava. That anything which inspires awe and the feeling of Aishwarya, that how powerful, how glorious, that is simply a reflection of Krishna's glory. And therefore, that should be understood as a reflection of Krishna. And when we see that, when we are faced with that, we automatically start feeling, I am insignificant. So therefore, it is very easy to artificially fold hands and say, I am humble, I am insignificant. But Krishna will arrange for us situations where we see right in front of us such magnificent activities performed by people of this world, performed by the devotees, performed by those whom we are, you know, in relationship with. Automatically, that creates humility in the heart, because we realize, I am nothing, I am insignificant. And therefore, that feeling of insignificance is the beginning of binding Krishna in a relationship of love. And so Yashoda Maheshi glorifies Krishna and she says, Aham mamasau patiresha mesuto vrajeshvarasya akhila vittapasati gopyascha gopa sahagodhanascha me yan mayaya me kumati samegati. Yashoda Maheshi says, I was thinking that I am great. I was thinking that I am the queen of Vraja. I was thinking that I have influence over all the gopis and the gopas, they belong to me. I was thinking all the cows belong to me, all this land belong to me. But actually, yan mayaya me kumati. This was actually my fallacious thinking. It was false. I was under illusion. And now I realize that I have no power. I am simply insignificant. And therefore may my mind and intelligence be reposed at the lotus feet of that Supreme. Like that. Somebody asked Srila Prabhupada that we heard that Lord Ram ate meat in the forest. So Prabhupada said he can eat the whole universe, including you. So you cannot compare with the Aishwarya or the power of the Supreme Lord. And therefore, the Aishwarya of the Lord is very important for us to start understanding our insignificance. But here, with respect to Krishna, he has appeared in the material world specifically so that he can reciprocate with the Brajavasis and experience the love of being controlled by the Brajavasis' love. And so when he sees that Yashoda Mai is experiencing Aishwarya, she is folding her hands and about to offer prayers, so Krishna is nervous. Why Krishna is nervous? Krishna is nervous because he thinks that who will feed me this milk? Who will chastise me? All the pleasure which I am experiencing with Mother Yashoda, that relationship will suddenly change. And immediately Krishna covers Yashoda Mai by his yoga maya potency. And so at that point Yashoda Mai's experience of Aishwarya is covered over. Sadyo nashta smritir gopi. So at that point Yashoda Mai's smriti or remembrance of that Aishwarya is destroyed. Saropya aroham atmanah pravriddha sneha kalilam hridayasit yathapura. And at that point Yashoda Mai's Sneha again started rising within her heart. Hridaya asit yatha pura, like before. And Yashoda Mai immediately takes Krishna and places him on her lap. And at that time, Shukadeva Goswami quotes this beautiful verse, which is known as the Paribhasha Sutra of the 10th canto Srimad Bhagavatam, of the Vatsalya Ras, of the Vrindavan Leela. And Shukadeva Goswami says, Traya cha upanishadbhischa sankhya yogaischa satvatai upagiyamana mahatmyam harersa amanyata putraka. He says that all the three Upanishads, Traya cha upanishadbhischa, in all the various Upanishads, in all kinds of other literatures of the Vedas, Sankhya, Yoga Shastras, all of these different literatures are simply glorifying Krishna as the supreme worshipable personality of Godhead. Upagiyamana mahatmyam harersa amanyata putrakaha. But here, Yashoda Mai, that personality who is worshipable for the entire universe, is considered by Yashoda Mai to be her own son. That means, in spite of having shown the entirety of the power of Krishna, after seeing such display of power and potency of Aishwarya, a person gets very much affected. And it is very difficult for a person to again regain a relationship of loving affection, because every time he regains that relationship, he is fearful when again the display of power will come. And therefore, having displayed and witnessed Aishwarya, it is very difficult to again enter into a relationship which is that of intimacy. And therefore, here we find that Mother Yashoda was covered over by Krishna's potency. And then Krishna could actually reciprocate again as a son. Like one devotee was sharing with me that his personality many years ago had a very strict personality, very heavy. Anybody would come near him would start trembling. So then he saw that, you know, devotees are keeping away and not coming close and all that. So then he started asking some other senior devotees, what should I do? You know, looks like people are too much affected by my Aishwarya. So that devotee suggested, you smile. You know, don't always be nursing bhav. Smile also, it'll be nice. And then when he started doing that, you know, after some time he came to this devotee who counseled him and said, you know, I tried what you are saying. And what was the effect? He said, the devotees say that when you are looking angry, okay, we are afraid. When you start smiling, we become more afraid. What will come next? So therefore, when you see the display of power, after that, you keep some distance. And so, here, although Yashoda Mai saw the entirety of Krishna's display of Aishwarya, Krishna was very afraid. It was opposite. Krishna was fearful that Yashoda Mai's relationship with me should not change. She should not start worshipping me. She should not take me in the lap and start offering aarti. She should not start glorifying me. I want to be chastised by her. I want to be loved by her in the mood of intimacy. And therefore, when you do something and you want to counteract the effect of what you have done, you go out of the way. And therefore, in the 9th chapter, Krishna wanted to perform a pastime by which even if now and then some traces of memory come in Yashoda Mai's mind sometimes, because any incident which happens, it can come in the mind anytime. You know, Yashoda Mai is giving milk and suddenly she remembers that, array, this is the Virat Roop. She leaves right in the middle. So that is not a good thing. Right? One devotee asked Srila Prabhupada, a guest had come, that we see that in your temple you are keeping Radha Krishna for worship. Who will take them seriously? Krishna is looking so sweet, playing upon flute. People of this yuga are so dangerous, they won't bow down in front of such a sweet looking God. Instead of Krishna, you must install Virat Roop in all your temples. So Prabhupada said, okay, possible, but the question is, who will dress Virat Roop? And the next question is, what bhoga you will offer? Because he eats everything. So yes, the Virat Roop was shown by Krishna to Arjuna to inspire the mood of worship. But here Krishna is very conscious of the fact that, no, I do not want Yashoda Mai to spin into that mood. And I want her to regain her feeling of intimacy. And therefore, Namami Ishwaram, that Ishwar is Satchidananda Rupam. He is actually having the form of Satchit and Ananda. He is having the form of eternity, bliss and knowledge. Yadaro Marandra Paripurti Varaha Daksha Varaha Janmani Babhu Ramis Samudra Tamanama Natha Aravinda Drisham Yashoda Panir Dvayantam Snapayam Babhuva. Bilwa Mangal Thakur says, when Varahadev appears, Varahadev's form is Satchit Ananda, and it is so huge that in one hair pore of Varahadev's body, that hair pore of Varahadev's body is so huge that the entirety of all the ocean water can enter inside one hair pore and still it will not flood. All of the water in the entire ocean of this world can enter into one hair pore, but still it will not flood. That is the size of one skin pore of Varahadev's form. So can you imagine what is Varahadev's entire form like? We cannot imagine. And therefore it is so gigantic that same Varahadev appears as Krishna. Tamanama Natha Aravinda Drisham Yashoda. And when that same Krishna appears as Yashoda Nandan, Yashoda Mai takes a bucket of water and bathes Krishna. So the question is, are both Krishna? Are both the Lords, the Supreme Lord? Are they both the same? Right? By scientific understanding of Archimedes' principle, it is not. It is not possible. So therefore, this Supreme Lord is having a form which is Sat, Chit and Ananda, and he appears in various leelas, in various forms. And in this particular form, he decides to reciprocate with Mother Yashoda. Lasat Kundalam Gokule Brajamanam. And he decides to spend his time in the midst of the gopis. The house wives of the gopas in the Brajbhumi Gokul area. And so Krishna spends more time with the Braj gopis. And so the Bhagavatam describes that Krishna wants to demonstrate that he is conquered by the power of love of the Brajavasis and not by any other power. And so Vrindavan is devoid of any symbols of power, like the lion, like the elephant, like any symbols of extreme military power. Vrindavan is recognized by its sweetness. Parrots, peacocks, cowherd boys, cowherd girls, the cows, the calves, Tulasi, Brindadevi. So there is nothing extrinsically powerful about any of these tattvas. But the sweetness of their love is the most powerful force which conquers Krishna. And so Uddhava says, Yanmartya Lilopaikum Swayoga Maya Balam Darashaita Grihita Vismapanam Swasacha Saubhagarde Parampadam Bhushana Bhushanangam. That Krishna's form is so beautiful that Krishna's bodily limbs, they cannot be decorated and their beauty enhanced by any ornament. When Krishna's limbs are in contact with any ornament, the beauty of that ornament is enhanced. So normally if someone wears an ornament, they will come and people will come and say, oh, this looks so beautiful. Your ears look so beautiful with this earring. But in Krishna's case, people come and compliment the earring. You look so beautiful in contact with Krishna's earlobes. So therefore, Lasat Kundalam Gokule Bhrajamanam refers to how every limb of Krishna enhances the beauty of the ornaments, and every reciprocation of Krishna enhances the ecstasy within the heart of the Brajavasis. And therefore, this beauty, the ultimate principle of beauty in creation, is defeat. And therefore, Krishna wants to enhance this principle. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, 4th canto, it is described, Sarva Saundarya Sangraham. Lord Vishnu is described to be the sum total of all beauties. In that purport, Srila Prabhupada writes beautifully by giving the example of the Goswamis, by giving the example of Hanumanji, by giving the example of how Krishna loves to be defeated by his devotees' love, and Krishna loves to give credit to his devotees. So therefore, there may be different types of attractive beauties in this world, but the most powerful, compelling beauty of all is the ability to give credit to others. And Krishna loves to give credit to his devotees and loves to be conquered by his devotees' love. And therefore, Gokule Bhrajamanam, Krishna is enjoying in the beauty of Braj Bhumi, which is how Krishna is conquered by the devotees' love and he gives credit to the Brajavasis. Like Krishna and Sridhama, when they wrestle in Gokul. So Krishna is considered to be the controller of the 33 crore demigods. When Akrura enters Krishna, he glorifies Krishna's lotus feet by saying, Yadarchitam Brahma Bhavadibi Surai Shriyacha Devya Munyacha Satvate. That Krishna's lotus feet are being glorified and worshipped by the 33 crore demigods. They are being aspired for by Lakshmi. Yadarchitam Brahma Bhavadibi Surai Shriyacha Devya. But Krishna's lotus feet are chasing behind the calves of Vrindavan. So therefore Krishna is all powerful, but in Braj Bhumi, in Gokul, he is playing with his cowherd boyfriends, and especially Krishna loves to have wrestling match with Sridhama. And then what is the general result of that? Sridhama always wins. And therefore when Krishna killed Kamsa, and the whole assembly was glorifying Krishna, the Brajavasis who were there, and Krishna was standing right there on the top, sitting on top of Kamsa's dead body, Sridhama came there and he challenged Krishna. He said, hey, I am used to defeating you every day. How can you defeat this person? You cannot be Krishna. Someone so powerful cannot be Krishna, because Krishna is pretty weak. I can defeat him. How can he kill Kamsa? Not possible. This is some fraud going on. I have question about this identity of this person. So if you are Krishna, I want to test, let's have a wrestling match. So in the same arena where Krishna killed Chanur, Mushtik and Kamsa, Sridhama and Krishna started wrestling. And what happened? Krishna got defeated. Sridhama gets up and says, confirm, this is Krishna. I certify. So, you know, one day, on a typical day, Krishna and Sridhama, they divide in two groups, wrestling match. And then as Krishna and Sridhama are facing each other, Krishna thinks, okay, let me have a psychological advantage by speaking. When you are fighting, you try to bewilder the other person by speaking various things. So Krishna said, you are trying to fight against me? You are trying to defeat me? Do you know who I am? Sridhama said, nobody knows you more than me. Krishna looks at Sridhama and says, no, you don't know. I am the supreme personality of Godhead. Sridhama says, ah, supreme personality of Godhead. Very good, very good. I know the supreme personality of Godhead. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So Sridhama is sarcastically responding. Krishna says, hey, how do you think Putana got killed? I killed Putana. You don't know? All of you guys were almost finished inside Aghasur's mouth. I entered Aghasur and finished him. And this Govardhan, I was the one who lifted Govardhan, otherwise all of you would be finished. So Sridhama started laughing loudly. And he started saying, just see the extent of this nonsense. What is going on here? And Sridhama advertised it loudly to all the cowherd boys. This is what Krishna is saying. And all the cowherd boys started laughing as if that was the biggest joke. And then Sridhama started saying that, hey, what is this? You are saying that you killed Putana. It was only because of Yashoda Mai's prayers that Putana got killed. And as far as Agasur, we had already entered and did the major job. You simply came in and took the credit for killing. And then as far as Govardhan is concerned, after making so many offerings by the Brajavasis and offering so much affection and love, Govardhan Giriraj became so happy, so blissful, he became weightless. And you are taking credit. You just kept your hand in that pose. But Govardhan by its own free will was just flying in the sky. So therefore stop taking such false credit, supreme personality of Godhead. So Krishna internally is bewildered, internally is blissful, although externally is thinking, oh, why they are not accepting me? So this is what gives him pleasure in Vrindavan. Ahoti dhanyam brajago ramanya stanyam ratam pita mati vate muda. Yasam vibho vatsataratmajatmaja yatriptye adhyapina chalamadvura. Millions of tons of ghee have been offered to Krishna since time immemorial in yajnas. But that did not satisfy Krishna as much as the milk which he drank for that 1 year. From the Brajavasis, from the cows, when Krishna took the form during Brahma Vimohan Leela as the calves and the cowherd boys, that gave him more pleasure, that gave him more bliss. So lasat kundalam gokule brajamanam, he is really experiencing that bliss. And then it says, yashoda bhiyolukha lavdhava manam paramrishtam atyantato drutya gopya. So there are three reasons why this particular pastime has been conducted. Various reasons are there. The first reason is Krishna wanted to glorify Yashoda Mai and the love of Yashoda Mai. And so Parikshit Maharaj asked this question to Shukadeva Goswami that in the last life, Vasudev and Devaki were the ones who performed such unlimited austerities so that they could get Krishna as their son. So they performed austerities as Prishni and Sutapa, and Krishna appeared as their son, but then ultimately Krishna seemed to be giving more mercy to Yashoda Mai than Vasudeva and Devaki. Is it not? So therefore the way Krishna behaves seems to be very mysterious. If someone came and said that you keep chanting Hare Krishna, he will go back to Godhead. Continue with enthusiasm. So then a person will get bewildered that, oh, is there a correlation between what I do and what I get? And so therefore, why is Yashoda Mai so much favored? And so in response to that, Shukadeva Goswami in the 9th chapter speaks this pastime. And so, to increase Yashoda Mai's fame, Nemam Virincho Na Bhavo Na Shrir Api Anga Samshraya, Krishna did not give such mercy to Brahma, to Shiva, even to Lakshmi, who's constantly in contact with Krishna's chest. What mercy Krishna gave to Yashoda Mai. Yashoda Leb Nemam Virincho Na Bhavo Na Shrir Api Anga Samshraya Prasade Lebhire. That prasad, that mercy which Yashoda Mai got, the opportunity to consider Krishna as her own son and feed Krishna and please Krishna and nourish Krishna. Yattat prapya vimuktidat. So in this way, Krishna wanted to demonstrate the glory of Yashoda Mai, the power of Yashoda Mai. And so, paramrishtam atyantato drutya gopya. So the pastime where Krishna, he breaks the pot because he is angry that Mother Yashoda kept me down and did not allow me to continue drinking her milk. So Chakravarti Pad explains that Krishna is revealing to the demigods, revealing to the 33 crore demigods, revealing to the worshippers of all those demigods, revealing to those who are inspired and affected and impacted by display of power and glory, that this is where we should bow down. This is where we will get the real reciprocation. This is the real essence. That no, just see, if any of you are worshipping me for my powers, in this pastime, I am renouncing all those powers. So the first quality of Krishna is Atma Rama. Atma Rama means one who does not desire anything outside of himself, one who is self-satisfied. Here he becomes desirous of Yashoda Mai's milk. So he's renounced his Atmaram Swabhav. Second quality of Krishna is Apta Kama. Apta Kama means he's satisfied with insignificant offering. And that is one of the special features of Krishna. Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam Yome Bhaktya Prayachati. Offer me with love and devotion, little bit. And therefore when Brahmaji in the Vamandev Leela, he sees that Lord Vamana has tied up Bali Maharaj, Brahmaji becomes very agitated and he comes to Vamandev and he is arguing on behalf of Bali Maharaj that, my dear Lord, in Shastras you claim that you are satisfied very easily with insignificant offering. Here the person has given the entire three worlds, all the 14 planetary systems he has offered. Still you are not satisfied? Looks like you have to change the Shastric statement. How is it that you are not still satisfied? Yat padayor ashatadhir salilam prada. You say in Shastra that if you offer just a little bit of water, you are satisfied. So when Brahmaji pleads on behalf of Bali Maharaj, then Vamanadeva explains why he performed this pastime. So therefore, aptakam means Krishna is satisfied even with a little offering. A little bit of offering, Krishna is satisfied. But here, he says, yes, I am aptakam, but just see, I am renouncing that nature. Yashoda Mai has fed me milk for some time, then she leaves me behind and chases that milk, which is kept on the stove. I have renounced the ocean of milk. I have renounced the ocean of milk to take appearance in this material world
and having renounced ocean of milk and come here, she is chasing few liters of milk. They don't understand my value, my power. I still need more milk. I am hungry for that. So therefore, he renounces his quality as aptakama. And then, at this point of time, when he breaks all of the pots and Yashoda Mai becomes angry and starts chasing him, Lord Krishna as Gopal demonstrates that the world knows me as one who is beyond the influence of the modes of nature. But I become angry when Yashoda Mai leaves me on the ground. When she leaves me, when she chases that milk, I feel a sense of rejection. I do not like this. And therefore that feeling of anger means Krishna is renouncing his swabhava as Trigunatit, one who has conquered, or one who is beyond the influence of the modes, because Rajogun controls Krodha or anger. So he's saying, I am not Trigunatit, I am renouncing my nature as Trigunatit. Then, normally, Krishna is glorified as Lakshmipati. Sudama glorifies Krishna as Kvaham Daridra Papiyam Kva Krishna Shri Niketana. He is Shri Niketana. Brahma Bandhaiti Smaham Bhavbhyam Parirambhita. Krishna, he is the husband of the goddess of fortune, Lakshmipati. And Lakshmipati Krishna is now becoming a thief. And he is stealing butter. He is breaking all the pots and distributing that butter. And therefore, Lakshmipati has become a thief. He is renouncing his position as the owner and controller of all opulences. And then when Yashoda Mai comes and starts threatening, so at this point when Yashoda Mai is chasing Krishna, what happens? Yashoda bhiyolu khalav dhavamanam. He is running out of fear of Mother Yashoda. So he is renouncing his fifth quality, that Krishna is known as one who gives fear to fear personified. He is kala personified. Krishna is known as bhayapaha bhayatita. One who is beyond fear, one who gives fear to fear personified. Madbhayad vati vatoyam suryastapati madbhayad. Out of fear of Krishna, the nature is moving. The will of the Lord is the most fearful force. He says, I am running out of fear of Mother Yashoda. So if any of you are approaching me out of fear, please know and see this particular form of mine where I am extremely fearful. And therefore, he is renouncing this aspect of his personality also. Rudantam muhur netra yugmam mrijantam karam bhoja yugmena sa atanka netram. Okay, bhaya is one level where one knows there is some fear. One has some fear. Right? You know, lecture is going on and suddenly as you are hearing the lecture, suddenly a fear comes. Will I get prasad? You look around and see the crowd is quite a lot. And then when I go, then maybe if I am 15 minutes late, I may not get prasad. That is called fear. Then when you reach the counter and then you hear the kirtan of the sound of the chamcha against the stainless steel vessel, tong, 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 then what comes is atanka. Atanka means when your worst fears are right in front of you and you cannot escape. And therefore, those who create terror, they are called atankavadi. That means they are right there and you can't just offer prayers to them and pacify them. So Yashoda Mai, when she holds that stick, Krishna's heart is filled with terror. And so, rudantam muhur netra yugmam mrijantam. So Krishna is saying that you are coming with tears in your eyes you know, offering prayers to me, but I am also crying. Rudantam muhur netra yugmam rajantam karam bhoja yugmena sa atanka netram. So the eyes of Krishna are filled with fear. Muhushvasa kampa, and his, you know, Brahma Samhita says, yaseka nishvasita kalam athavalamba. From the pores of Mahavishnu, unlimited universes come out. Right? When Mahavishnu exhales, all the universes come out. When Mahavishnu inhales, all the universes come in. And so that is the power of one breath. So therefore the Lord's breath is very powerful. Right? So somebody was talking to one devotee and asking, how long all of these problems will continue? How long will these problems continue? And this devotee replied, till Mahavishnu inhales. As long as the material world remains, this will continue. Somebody came to our gift shop and he was seeing Krishna art book. And different photos he was seeing, not so impressed. Then one photo he stopped and said, wow, this is the best. This is my aspiration. And then, you know, the devotee saw, what was that photo? It was Mahavishnu sleeping. And he said, why do you like this one? He says, are so raha aur kaam bhi ho raha. He's sleeping and work is also going on. Only he can do that. We cannot do. So in one exhalation, so much activity is happening. And again he is sobbing and crying, inhaling and exhaling in front of Mother Yashoda out of fear. And so here, that sthita graiva muhushvasa kampa trirekhaka kantha, and then the beauty of Krishna's form is described, that generally when someone is sad, someone is afraid, these are negative emotions, they decrease one's beauty. But in Krishna's case, when he becomes fearful, when he becomes sad and he starts crying, that enhances his beauty, which shows that this is the absolute nature of Krishna. So therefore, we cannot judge Krishna with our senses. In Calcutta, Prabhupada was there taking darshan. One devotee came to Prabhupada and said, Srila Prabhupada, those who have dressed Krishna have made a mistake. Prabhupada said, what is the mistake? And he said, they have kept the flute of Krishna opposite direction. The holes of the flute have to be away from the mouth. But all the holes are towards the mouth. And that single hole is away from the mouth. Prabhupada said, what do you think? Krishna can't play flute upside down. Krishna can play the flute in any direction. So, it's okay. Then Prabhupada said, but make sure you put it in the right direction. So, Krishna's form is completely transcendental. And his beauty is being described. And so, sthita graivam damodaram bhakti. And Yashoda Mai is somehow trying to tie Krishna up with the rope. And this is the second reason why the pastime is being performed, to demonstrate the supremacy of bhakti and devotion. The first reason is to glorify Yashoda Mai. The second reason is to demonstrate how bhakti is supreme. Bhakti Baddham. And therefore, how this happens is very beautifully described, that as Yashoda Mai is tying up Krishna with ropes one after another, Krishna refuses to be bound. And it is always two fingers too short. And so Shukadeva Goswami says, Swamatu Svinnagatraya Visrishta Kabara Sraja Drishtva Parishramam Krishna Kripayasit Swabandhane. So this is the classic verse which comes right at the point when Krishna agrees to be bound. So this verse has been commented upon by acharyas a lot. Okay, so the question is asked, why Krishna was not getting bound? So the gopis are saying to your mother Yashoda that actually Yashoda Mai, just give up your activity, give up your effort. So many ropes you have called for, we have brought all those ropes, you are trying repeatedly. It is not in Krishna's destiny to be bound. The gopis make a statement. They are not saying that you cannot bind. They are saying it is not in Krishna's destiny to be bound. So why they are making this statement? Because they know that Krishna has a tendency to take challenge. And when Krishna is told, oh, you cannot be bound. They say, oh, I cannot be bound, I will become bound. Sometimes that psychology is there. You know, you tell, please, can you do this seva? Mm-hmm. Can you do this? Can you do this? You can never do this. Hey, why not? I will do. We enter like that into this. Right? I remember when Radhanath Maharaj in 2006 was saying that we must improve the kitchen. We must improve the kitchen. We were also saying, yeah, we must improve. We must improve. So we will hire somebody here, we'll hire somebody. No, we should somehow improve. You all must get involved. I said, yeah, yeah, yeah. Good idea. And then at one point he lost his patience and finally said, you are spaced out brahmacharis. You can never do anything. So, what is this? Right? And then I was telling one devotee, please take up this responsibility. Please take up. Please take up. He said, ye kabhi nahi sudharega kitchen. He said that, boof, that went in my heart. And that was the provocation, you know, which made me enter. Nahi, kabhi nahi sudharega, kaise nahi sudharega. So here, you know, the gopis are telling Krishna, you can never be bound. One devotee, you know, he was sharing this experience. That there is this sannyasi, he was preaching to one person, was a life member for many years, for 20 years. 20 years he was connected to the devotees, but not giving up onion garlic. So finally this sannyasi was preaching to him, got fed up and said, in this lifetime you can never give up onion and garlic, you are the most fallen. Next day he gave up. So it will not work every time. But here Yashoda Mai is told by the gopis, Krishna cannot be bound because it is not in his destiny. So Krishna hears that. Oh, I have been given a challenge. Secondly, Krishna also does not like to be insulted in front of his, you know, cowherd boyfriends and others. And therefore, you know, Krishna is delaying this. So here the word used is kripayasit swabandhane. So this is very interesting. Who's trying to tie up Krishna? Yashoda Mai, Swamatu. So Yashoda Mai is trying, putting the effort, and when finally Krishna agrees to be bound, the word used is swabandhane. He got bound by himself. For 12 hours from sunrise till sunset, Yashoda Mai was trying to bind Krishna. For 12 hours Yashoda Mai was trying, and the word used is swabandhane. He got bound by his own. So this shows that without Krishna's desire, so there are two things referred to here. One is Krishna has a certain preference. And when Krishna prefers, desires, decides to be bound, only then he can be bound. That is the first aspect of bhakti, which separates bhakti from jnana, karma, yoga, where the sadhaka's effort is all powerful. But here, in bhakti, apart from sadhaka's effort, a very important element of Krishna's will comes in. And therefore, bhakti is the process by which we have to gradually give up the ego, the false ego, that I am powerful, I am strong. And so Without Lord's will and desire, nothing can happen. And secondly, Yashoda Mai here is considered to be non-different from Krishna. When Krishna feels that this devotee is non-different from me, so when Yashoda Mai is binding Krishna, Krishna is accepting Yashoda Mai is actually as good as me, non-different from me. And that non-difference is not in terms of becoming one and merging into the Supreme like the impersonalist, but that non-difference is in the desire. And therefore, Iha sabara konamate hoibe nistar, tahara hetuna dekhiye edukh apar. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is having a conversation with Haridas Thakur and he's saying, Haridas, when I see the suffering of all of these yavanas of this world, of Kali Yuga, by seeing that suffering, great anxiety rises in my heart. I do not know how all of these souls of Kali Yuga will be delivered. Haridas Thakur replies, Haridas kohe Prabhu chinta na koriha, yavanera samsara dekhi dukha na bhaviha. My dear Lord, do not be in anxiety. Yavanera samsara dekhi dukha na bhaviha. By this chanting of the Mahamantra through this Sankirtan, they will not experience any more dukkha. Chintana kuriha. So Prabhupada writes in the purport, this conversation between Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Haridas Thakur is very crucial as it demonstrates what it means to be a dedicated servant. And a dedicated servant is one who is one in desires with the Lord and the Lord's devotees. So therefore, there are five elements which are crucial in this process of becoming swabandhane, of how we can actually bind Krishna. The first is shravan. We have to hear the instructions from the Vaishnavas. We hear the desire, and when we hear the desire, maybe sometimes the desire is not as per what we expect. And we may get bewildered. And we may not want to, you know, do as per that. So the second principle is very important, that after we hear, we have to somehow harmonize our desire with those desires. And that is called samanvaya. So when there is shravan, then the shravan must be followed by samanvaya, harmonizing that. Prabhupada was in Vrindavan and one of the devotees, you know, there, he was doing bhajan for a long time and Prabhupada wanted him to actually go out and preach. So Prabhupada told him that you have spent a long time in Vrindavan, you should go and preach. He looked at Prabhupada and said, preach? Where will I preach? Prabhupada looked at him and said, I wanted to go and preach in Sri Lanka. So he looked at Prabhupada and said, Sri Lanka, very small country. Prabhupada said, okay, go to Pakistan. He said, oh, Sri Lanka is better. And then, you know, he said, okay, let me try preaching there. So sometimes we may get an instruction and we may not immediately like it. So it is not easy to do the samanvaya. The third step is you actually do the seva. So sometimes even if the samanvaya is not there, even if one starts performing the seva, then the fourth step is when you perform the seva, there are difficulties, there are challenges. So one must have sahishnuta. So without tolerance, there is no question of seva. And then when you keep performing that service, maybe as a result of performing that service, you will get realization based on which there is samanvaya. And then the harmony follows. So ideally the harmony must precede the service. But at the sadhaka state, sometimes we may begin the service and tolerate. And then the fruit of that service may be an experience of harmony, that yes, Now I am convinced why I did this service. Like Hanumanji was given the ring, Hanumanji was not convinced. He was thinking, why Ram is crying so much? Mahatma should not cry. Mahatma should be equipoised. Why is crying? Not good. Lord Ram understood. He is Brahmachari. He cannot understand. How he will understand? He has to have experience. How? Of seeing Sita. So he gave the ring to Hanumanji, smiled at him and said, go. So Ram knew why he is giving. Hanumanji didn't know at that time. When Hanumanji looked at Sita, and he looked at Sita and the fragile beauty of Sita, Hanumanji immediately says, Dushkaram Kritavan Ramau Hinoyat Anaya Prabhu. That how come? I am thinking right now, after seeing Sita, Hanumanji is thinking, does Ram have a heart here or is he having stone here? After being in separation from such a divine lady, how can he still survive? How is he still alive? So Hanuman went to other extreme. So therefore, sometimes we are convinced samanvaya, and that samanvaya is not just because I always wanted to do this service, I got it, oh, I'm in harmony. But the impetus is, I do this because it is the will of the master. It is the will of the Vaishnavas. It is the will of Krishna. Sometimes that will may coincide with what we may also want. Like evam samprarthito viprasva chikirshitam evayat chakara namakaranam gudho rahasi baleo. You know, Gargacharya, he was very inspired to perform the name giving ceremony to Krishna. But still he wanted to make sure that he is instructed. And only when again and again Nanda Maharaj insisted, you must. So then he said, okay. So therefore the important thing is from where the instruction is coming, from where the desire is manifesting. And so when there is Shravan, Samanvay, Seva, Sahishnu, then there is Santosh, that you are able to actually satisfy the person whom you are trying to serve. That gives the experience of Smaranam, of remembrance of Krishna. And that Smaranam, Krishna Smaranam, remembrance of Krishna, is the ultimate goal. It is a success in devotional principles. And so here we find that Swabandhane is referred to as Yashoda Mai is thinking, I am binding Krishna. Krishna is thinking, I am binding myself. Because Yashoda Mai and myself are almost non-different because the desires are so harmonious. And so, why the Lord did not agree to get bound is described here. That first of all, Krishna wanted to jump back on the lap of Yashoda Mai. Krishna was very angry. Why Yashoda Mai put me on the ground? So I want to go back on her lap. And why he want to go back on the lap? Because he want to actually smell the sweat of Yashoda Mai, which is mixed with Aguru. So Matu Swinna Gatra, Yashoda Mai's body completely covered with sweat. But Krishna loves to actually experience the hard work of the devotees. And so also Krishna wants to see Yashoda Mai's beautiful form, which is mixed with anger and love. Krishna wants to hear the heartbeat of Yashoda Mai, which is mixed with her feelings of agitation. Rainfall is always good, but when the rainfall is intermittently mixed with thundering sound, it is even more blissful. So therefore, Krishna wanted to actually experience Yashoda Mai's love by sitting back on her lap. And so, also, so matu swinna gatraya, the drops of perspiration from Yashoda Mai's beautiful form, they were also personalities. They were looking at Krishna and begging, "Arey, please get bound, Baba. How much more seva we have to do?" So therefore, they were also offering their prayers. And so at that point, you know, it is described that the lesson which is given by Krishna to the sadhakas, Krishna was not getting bound, that through Yashoda Mai, I also want to give a lesson to the sadhakas. And what is that lesson? That when you start performing the sadhana bhakti, Visrishta Kavarasraja Drishtva Parishramam Krishna, that it is not going to be so easy. You begin the bhakti, it may appear everything is blissful. What is bhakti? Oh, come to temple, eat halwa, go. That may be in the beginning. One person was coming to a temple in Europe, and then as soon as he would come for darshan, the pujari would come and give sweet rice. And he said, for whom? For you. For why? You are coming for darshan. You are special. You are antarayami prerit. You are inspired by the Lord. You are a special guest of the Lord. So he felt very good. Next day he came again, the pujari came. Come here. Sweet rice. Third day, come here. Sweet rice. He said, oh, wonderful. After 1 month he decided, let me stay here only. Once he stayed there, the pujari called him again, come here. He went running. He gave the sweet rice and give it to him, new person who has come. So therefore, the first principle is that as we keep practicing, the results may not come. So Yashoda Mai was going through the first experience of fatigue. Swinnagatraya, she was becoming fatigued. So while performing sadhana, one may experience fatigue. Yes, we perform many activities which may have an experience of fatigue, but at least if success comes, it is worth it. We forget that fatigue. But if fatigue is followed by failure, it is even more difficult. That, oh, nothing came out. I got tired also. And the result did not come out also. So what is the point? So therefore, yes, we keep chanting, we keep performing bhajan, we keep performing activities as part of anartha nivritti. And just going through the process of bhajan on a daily basis, it is also filled with austerity and fatigue. Many years ago, one devotee stayed in the ashram for 2-3 years, then he was leaving. On the way out, I asked him, why you are leaving? Prasad not good? No, prasad very good. Association difficult? No, very good. You didn't get sufficient seva? No, I got lot of seva. You got too much seva? No, I got moderate. Why you are leaving? Any feedbacks you have on how we should improve? He said, yeah, one thing you can improve, make Mangal Arati 10 o'clock in the morning. Now, is that possible? That's not possible. So every day getting up in the morning, doing this 16 round, doing this, doing that, do's and don'ts and this and that. One person was telling me, I come to the ISKCON temple with so much tension, aapka lecture sunke tension badh jata hai. Ye mat karo, wo mat karo, don't do this, don't do that. So yes, it's a process. And that process itself may create some fatigue if one is especially not experiencing any reciprocation. Right? And then you may wonder, this is anartha nivritti or anartha pravritti? What is going on? So therefore, fatigue followed by failure is still okay. But then as Yashoda Mai could not bind Krishna, all the other gopis were coming and giving advice to Yashoda Mai. You know what? You are not using the right quality ropes. You know this is not the right time to do it. You should not have done like this. Why don't you try this? Why don't you try that? The third big challenge is feedback. Right? And especially when things are not going right and people come up and keep giving other kinds of feedback, become very, very difficult. Very difficult. You cannot do anything about it. Many years ago in our yatra, we were, began the Vrindavan yatra and we made some items for the first 2-3 days. Then someone came and said, you should allow us to also cook. And so we gave them chance to cook. And then they made poha, which was totally tough, hard. And then I realized, it's going to be a hard day for me. So as I was trying to escape so that nobody sees me, otherwise they'll give feedbacks. So then one of our devotee caught me. And, you know, he's very experienced in giving feedback. So he looked at me and said, "Arey, kya poha khilaya, batti si toot gaye." My 32 teeth fell off. I said, "This is not poha, this is cornflakes." He said, "What? Cornflakes?" I said, "Yeah, you are supposed to mix with herbal tea and eat." He said, "Oh, really?" I said, "It was never announced. You never told me." I said, "You never asked me." He got sufficiently confused and I left. So when you perform service, that itself is tiring, then you don't get the result of what you are aspiring, that even bothers you further. Then on top of that, the feedbacks sufficient to finish you. So therefore, in spite of all of this, Yashoda Mai continued. Drishtva. This is what Krishna sees. What does Krishna see? Krishna sees three tattvas. First is the sadhu's parishram. When we put our effort and then based on that effort we try to please Krishna. So the three tattvas which are very important is, first of all, we need Bhagavat Shraddha. We need faith in saintly people. We need faith in the Vaishnavas. When we have Vaishnav Shraddha, when we have faith in the Vaishnavas, we get blessings of the Vaishnavas. By the blessings of the Vaishnavas, we get strength for Bhagavat Bhajan. So based on Vaishnav Shraddha, we get Bhajan Shraddha. Our faith in Bhajan is a direct component of the grace of the devotees. And then when Krishna sees, yes, he is dedicated to the process of Bhajan, then Krishna Kripa follows. So therefore our ability to be absorbed in Bhajan, just like Yashoda Mai was absorbed in the process of trying to tie up Krishna, is when in spite of fatigue, in spite of sense of failure, in spite of feedbacks, we continue pleasing the Vaishnavas and get their grace. Then, drishtva parishramam Krishna. And so it is described, what is the secret of these two fingers too short? As the famous, you know, example goes. So actually what was happening, why the delay was happening was, as Yashoda Mai was tying up Krishna with the ropes, there were various energies of Krishna who were at Krishna's mercy. And these energies always follow the energetic. So Krishna, he looked at all these energies. And what are these energies? There are 16 energies of Krishna. So Krishna said, "See, this is a very delicate matter. Yashoda Mai is trying to bind me. I am the all-powerful Supreme Lord. I am being bound. Now I leave to all of you. You decide. I will not decide. Whether Yashoda Mai should be allowed to bind me or not is your decision. All of you together make this decision." So the 16 energies, they started having their meeting. So why the delay in decision happened was, a big committee was discussing for 12 hours. And who are the 16 energies? Chakravarti Pad explains, the first is aparichinnata shakti, all pervasiveness, that makes sure that Krishna is all pervasive. Second is vibhuda, power, potency of Krishna. Third is shri shakti, that power which reflects Krishna's shri or opulence. Fourth is Gir Shakti, Krishna's knowledge potency. Fifth is Kanti. Gir is basically his, you know, intelligence. And Kanti is Krishna's beauty. Then Kirti is his fame, Tushti, satisfaction, Ila, Bhumi Shakti or tolerance, power, Urja is vigor, Vidya, the various kinds of knowledge, Mahamaya, Yogamaya, Kala, Vibhuti, Jiva. These are the 15 Shaktis which were on one side. And they were all saying, Krishna cannot be bound. Krishna cannot be bound. This is not possible. Why? Because if Krishna is bound, we will lose our seva. Fame was thinking that if Krishna is bound and he becomes prisoner, then Krishna is subjected to infamy. So the delay in decision happened was because there was insecurity about loss of service opportunity and loss of credibility. And what is the point of, you know, Kirti Shakti if Krishna is subjected to Akirti? So therefore, the Kirti Shakti has failed. That you are supposed to always ensure Krishna's fame goes on expanding, and now Krishna has become imprisoned. He is declared a thief. He is bound. So therefore, they were not agreeing. This is not possible. It was an existential crisis for them. So at this point, all of the 15 were on one side saying that Krishna's glory, power, influence, knowledge is so unlimited, it cannot be brought under the control of this rope of Mother Yashoda. But on the other side was the 16th Shakti, which is Kripa Shakti. Mercy, compassion was that one Shakti which was arguing and debating with each one of these Shaktis one by one and explaining how the mercy potency and the mercy of the Lord is more powerful than all of these put together. And so, as the debate continued, finally, when Krishna was asking, any conclusion, any conclusion, any conclusion, finally, Kripa Shakti came out and said that, yes, all the others have surrendered. And yes, everybody agrees that you must be bound by Mother Yashoda. And Krishna looked at all the Shaktis and said, okay, we also surrender. We agree to this. And therefore, in Vrindavan, Krishna is revealing the power of Kripa or the ultimate compassion of the Lord. And so Kripa defeats everything else, and Krishna agrees to be bound by the grace and the power of the grace. And only by that grace, by that Kripa, Krishna can be bound. So therefore, Sadhu Kripa gives Bhagavat Bhajan. And then the combination of Sadhu Kripa and Bhagavat Bhajan leads to Krishna Kripa. And so the two fingers refer to both Bhagavat Shraddha and Bhagavat Kripa. The two fingers also refer to the two sons of, you know, Nalakuver Manigriv. The two fingers also refer to, as a conventional, you know, two fingers too short means do log khade the yahan par, do char log the, a few people were there, two people were there. It doesn't, so Jiv Goswami says it is like conventional. And then the most famous is a combination of our endeavor and Krishna's grace. So drishtva parishramam Krishna. Drishtva parishramam refers to, shram means work. Pari means from all angles. Like for example, pari vrajakacharya means one who travels the whole world. And then we have parisar, compound, all around. Or parityag, giving up completely. Right? Parivartan, complete transformation. Or pariprashna, perfect question. Complete questions. Parivar, where there is complete war. Where there is You know, from all sides we are covered with the intimacy of relationship. We say, I have a family relationship with this person. There are five of us. We are closely bound like that, completely bound. So therefore, drishtva parishramam means Krishna is looking at Mother Yashoda and saying, is she working from every angle? Is she working hard from all angles? So that's how Krishna views how we perform our sadhana bhakti. Is our bhajan complete from all angles? This does not work. So do we give up or we try something else? This is not working. Do I give up or do I start something else? So drishtva parishramam. Parishram basically refers to how we approach our bhajan in a comprehensive manner with full determination that I will somehow or the other try to bring Krishna within my heart. So that is exactly what this refers to. Evam sandarshita hi anga harina bhritya vashyata svavashenapi krishnena yasyedam sa ishvaram vashe. So in this manner, sandarshita, Krishna wants to show and reveal that I come under the control of my devotee's love. So therefore he wants to propagate, I love being conquered by my devotees, to be bound, to be defeated, to be in a jail-like condition, to be imprisoned is not considered socially glorious, but I love this. And Krishna wants to demonstrate that ye yathamam prapadyante, that I am more than eager to be bound. You increase the intensity of your desire like Yashoda Mai. The ball is in your court. And Krishna wants to demonstrate that when I am not present, people have doubts, God exists or not. When I come, again they have doubt, that why is he behaving like this? So Krishna says, whether I am absent or present, people always create controversy out of me. So therefore I want to demonstrate once and for all that I am more than eager to be conquered by my devotee's love. And so therefore, iti drik sva lilabhir anandakunde svaghosham nimajjantam akhyapayantam tadiyeshita gyeshu bhaktair jitatvam. This is what I have come to demonstrate, that I am conquered by my devotee's love. This is my whole mission to show in Vrindavan. I am conquered by my devotee's love. This is my advertisement. Bhakti conquers over me. And then, you know, in the next verses, he starts asking benediction. The only benediction I ask from you is, may your beautiful form be visible to me. I do not want varam deva moksham na liberation, moksha vadhima vaikuntha, nachanyam vrineham vareshad. I do not want any of the effects of Shravan Kirtan and all. Idam te vapur nath gopalavalam. I just want this form of Krishna, which Yashoda Mai bound with the ropes of love, to be always resplendent in my heart. And then in the next verse, he takes darshan of Krishna more closely and says that idam te mukham bhojam atyanta nilair. I want to meditate only on your beautiful lotus-like face, which has been constantly kissed by Mother Yashoda. And that beauty is the only aspiration of my heart. I have no other aspiration. So having first of all offered, you know, his obeisances to the Supreme Lord in the first couple of verses, in the next verses he's offering his, you know, full absorption and prayer. Now he is offering what is his real aspiration, that please, my dear Lord, protect me and save me. Namo Deva, you are the controller of this universe. Damodar, you are bound by devotee's love. Ananta, you are unlimitedly powerful. You do not need anybody's permission to give you benediction. Vishnoho, you are present everywhere. You can't say, I can't hear you, you are too far away. No, you are right next to me because you are Vishnu. Prasida Prabho, please be pleased with me, O Prabho. Kartum akartum sarvata kartum iti Prabho. You can do and undo as you like. Jalabdhi magnam, I am struggling in this ocean of material existence. So first he expresses his insignificant suffering condition. Then, first he actually glorifies his power and then asks for a benediction. And so, kripa drishti vrishtyati dinam batanu grihanesha mam agyam edhi akshi drishya. So I was praying in the last two verses that you be manifest within my heart, but now I feel that why don't you manifest right in front of me so that I can see you all the time. So the Lord may say, whom do you think you are? You think you are so qualified that I should manifest in front of you? I don't think you are qualified. So Satyavrat Muni says, my dear Lord, I know some case studies where highly unqualified people were also delivered. Who's that? Kuver Atmajav Baddha Murteva Yadvat Tvaya Mochitav Bhakti Bhajav Kritavcha Tatha Prema Bhakti Swakame Prayacha. So those Nalakuver and Manigriv, what regulative principles they followed, I know. What Vaishnava etiquette they demonstrated, we know. How many rounds they had, we know. So, how come they got bhakti? So therefore, I don't want mukti and all. I want bhakti like you gave them. Right? So he is demanding now. Tatha prema bhakti svakame prayachya. I want that kind of bhakti only, that same flavor. If they can get without qualification, why I cannot get? So looks like there is no eligibility criteria in your whole system. So don't just bring some new rules and regulations, okay? Because we know what happened to them. Nalukuver and Manigriv. And so this is the third reason why the Damodar pastime was performed, to demonstrate that first was to show Yashoda Mai's glory, the second was to show the power of bhakti, and the third is to demonstrate the power of devotee's words. What comes out of the devotee's mouth is taken so seriously by me that I am willing to change the direction of my movements. And as Damodar is pulling on the ukkal, on the mortar, he remembers Narad Muni's words. Devarishi me priyatamo yadimau dhanadatmajau tattata sadhishyami angitam tan mahatmana rishir bhagavata mukhyasya satyam kartum vacho harir jagama shanakai satra yatrastam yamalarjuna. That because Narad Muni said Nalakuvar and Manigri will be delivered in future by me, I have to fulfill that desire. Because Krishna's desire, like a river, flows through the channel of the devotee's desire and devotee's words. The words spoken by the desire, the words spoken by the devotees act like the conduit through which Krishna's desire flows. And therefore, sadhunam samachittanam sutaramat kritatmanam darshanam no bhaved bandha pumsa akshnor savituryatha. When sun comes, darkness cannot remain. Like that, when devotees come, ignorance cannot remain, bondage cannot remain. Therefore, even after 20,000 years, so much time had passed, the devotee's desire, when expressed, remains in the eternal platform. Only time, which is Krishna's energy, separates that. That desire will get fulfilled at some point of time. The question is whether you and me are willing to be instruments in that desire. But we cannot change the desire expressed by the great souls. And therefore, when Narad Muni said they will be delivered, nobody counted, hey, they are not qualified, they did so many aparad, this, how you can give such a benediction? No. It was remaining. Just because something is not manifesting doesn't mean that expression of intent and desire is false. It will become true at some point of time. So therefore Krishna is saying, if I take the devotee's desire and what comes out of their lips so seriously, how much more seriously you should take it. If that desire expressed through the devotee's lips, the words of the devotees are so powerful, they can change the direction of the supreme controller, how much control and influence those words should have over your lives. Therefore, if you are in the movement of bhakti, then please understand that the bhakti tattva will not change. Whether after joining the bhakti movement, I figure out that the process of bhakti is too difficult for me, that is a different case. But we cannot try to justify our inability to follow the basic process of bhakti with other kinds of philosophical speculations, because that will not change the eternal principles of bhakti. And therefore, he wants to demonstrate this, that the will of the devotees rules my heart, decides the direction of how I proceed. And so he concludes this prayer by saying, Namastestu dhamne spurat deepti dhamne tvadiyo dhanaya vishvasya dhamne. I offer my glories to that rope which managed to tie up that Supreme Lord. That Lord is having all the universes within his belly. How can this rope tie that belly? My obeisances to that rope. Right? Because that rope becomes the instrument in glorifying the eternal principle of bhakti for all time to come. And so normally Janmashtami, Radhashtami and all we celebrate one day. But the glory of bhakti, the glory of bhakta, the glory of bhakta icha is being celebrated for a month. No other festival is celebrated like this for a month. And therefore, tvadiyodaraya the vishvasya dhamne. And then, you know, he's thinking, if there has been any shortcoming in my prayer, and I am after all offering my file in front of the Lord. And as all of you know, many times to process file, you know, you need some special recommendation, some connection, some kind of sifarish. So he says, Namo Radhikayai Twadiya Priyayai. So whether whatever I am offering he is accepting or not, if I add Radharani name on top, you know, आदेश कहां से आए? ऊपर से. नमो राधिकायै त्वदीय प्रियायै. And then if that is not sufficient, another favorite of Krishna is नमो अनंत लीलाय. He loves रास लीला. So if Radharani and Gopis, that whole thing is packaged with the grace of Radharani and the Gopis, 100% the file will pass. नमो अनंत लीलाय Devaya Tubhyam. And so Sanatan Goswami says that generally in a meal, Madhurena Samapayat, that sweets are distributed in the end, although in some communities it is in the beginning also. Sometimes it is beginning, middle, end also. But generally speaking, sweet is given in the end so that even if there has been, you know, something which is not been up to the mark in the cooking and the taste is off here and there and you are feeling frustrated while eating. What is this? Why it is like this? And the host is asking, how is it? Very nice, very nice. But then in the end, like I remember when we were staying together, Radhesham Prabhu, myself and Sudama Prabhu, I had cooked one day, I forgot to put salt. So Sudama Prabhu was looking at me like angry. And then I asked Radhesham Prabhu, how is it? He said, very sattvic, very sattvic. So if there is any shortcoming, Madhurena Samapayat. So therefore, you know, Sanatan Goswami says that in the seven verses, Satyavrata Muni has offered so many prayers asked for so many benedictions, made so many glorifications. If there has been any shortcoming in that, he wants to conclude with something really sweet, the grace of Radharani and the gopis. And therefore, in the beautiful month of Kartik, it is our great privilege that by Srila Prabhupada's grace, we get to offer our humble, insignificant prayers at the lotus feet of the unlimitedly powerful Lord, who agrees to be bound by the unlimited power of love. And that is one power the unlimitedly powerful Lord gives to the devotee, the power to love him unlimitedly. And if we grab that opportunity, utilize it, that becomes the perfection of our human form of life. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Thank you. So there's an announcement that there's a project name called Bhakton Ka Bharat, and the initiative taken is called Mission Mumbai, and the motto is Back to Godhead magazine in every home. So we have Balram Anand Prabhu, Yashoda Kumar Prabhu and Kunj Bihari Prabhu. Are they here?
Yeah, can you stand up?
So Balram Anand Prabhu, he has this wonderful announcement. So I think, why don't you only make? Because you'll carry the, you know, power.
Come.